go ahead and welcome y'all to Forensics Matter and Security. And it's my pleasure to introduce Paul Shummel from Guidance Software and their makers of NCSAM.
So just to get a familiarity with the audience, do we have any people that have used NCASE before? Okay, some familiarity. Okay, good. Well, just quick give you an introduction to me. 10 years ago in 2006, I was recruited into Guidance Software's new product research group. I'm a little different than probably people who talk at conferences. I was an R&D software developer. And in 2006, they launched the first product I know of that ingested SIM events and then did automated incident response. Fortunately, they called it the Automated Incident Response System, or AIRS, which mainly had the salespeople make fun of us and say we're selling thin air because it was a little bit ahead of its time. And I've been in new product research groups a couple times at companies, and they're generally short-lived. At this company, about 8 months into it, I think the executives kind of looked at us and said, what are you guys doing with this Ford stuff? Let's just break you up and stick you into the main line of R&D, which is what happened. And I spent years architecting and managing forensic and cybersecurity products. And these days, I manage open integrations. I manage a Caltech grant studying machine learning and malware detection. And I also do some writing to you, just to plug my work in dark reading. I write a regular article there, and I've also published in Security Week's InfoSec Island and IT Business Edge. Should we leave this slide? So what I want to do today is a couple things which I think are kind of interesting. One is I want to walk through a security breach, and I want to show you what it looks like from your adversary's point of view. I'm actually going to show you them operating malware and what their malware control consoles look like. And I want to kind of go through the different stages of the breach, and I want to plot out all the different forensic evidences left behind for the different activities that they engage upon. And I think what's interesting about this, I'm going to put it on a kind of a very specifically designed chart so that we can see at the end some patterns emerge that will give us some interesting takeaways. So how many people here are familiar with the cyber kill chain? It's pretty popular. Okay. I imagine there's some really advanced security people in here and some people that are new. So I'm just going to quick give a refresher on that for a very brief period of time. But the cyber kill chain is a really great model. It's been around for probably a decade. And it basically talks about the common activities that your adversary goes through during the different stages of the breach. And even though it's 10 years old, it holds pretty well because, humans are humans. They have certain activities they have to do to penetrate your organization and steal your sensitive data. And these are the seven stages that it covers. The first is reconnaissance. And that's them out in their own hacker layer, whatever you want to call it, locating targets, locating vulnerabilities. And then the second stage is weaponization, which is them building their tools, building their polymorphic malware, their zero days. And then delivery is actually getting something into your network, like a phishing email or a way that they can deliver malicious code into your organization. And then exploitation is the code actually starting to run on your endpoint through some visibility through some vulnerability or something a user did. And then the next stage over installation, it's what it says it is. It's whatever malicious code got you into the endpoint, if you're a bad actor, you know that you're going to be working on this organization in command and control for maybe a year. So this is the time when you would install the type of malware that you would use for the long haul. And then the next, of course, is command and control. That's when your endpoints are owned and they're controlled by an external entity. And lastly, if they're stealing your data, the last stage has often been called exfiltration. Sometimes people call this bad actions, or they have different names for it, depending if they're there to destroy your data or steal your data. But the last one is the bad one, where they do the damage to your organization. Now, this is a great model. There's some criticisms of this model. One is, it's not true that they go through steps 1 through 7 always in that order. Some people argue that it's cyclical, they'll cycle back through. And the other thing, criticism that I would make about this model that we're going to talk about here is it doesn't really emphasize which of these stages are most important to you. So I'm actually going to do this, the kill chain as a circle, and I'm going to start going clockwise from the top with the five stages of the cyber kill chain that actually occur within your network that you're dealing with as an InfoSec person. Starting with delivery, when something that the bad guys are doing touches your network, going down through exploitation, installation, command and control, and all the way up to the last stage when the damage is done. Now, the other thing that I'm doing is I'm not treating them all as the same. So if you notice, some of these, like exploitation, which is, I don't know, at 2 o'clock, it's really small. Because that, how long does it take for malicious code to initially execute on your machine? You know, less than a second maybe. Whereas once you're owned, the bad guys end up in command and control for many, many, many months. As a matter of fact, probably 90% of a breach, your adversary is in command and control. So that really should be the big emphasis of the cyber filter. The other thing I want to do, and what we're going to do is we're going to walk through a breach, and I'm going to be dropping little dots on here of forensic residue while showing you what your adversary is doing. And I want to drop these dots not just by walking from delivery through exploitation down through these pie slices, but I want to drop them, you know, with different degrees of depth in this circle. And the first degree of depth we're going to look at or drop a forensic residue on is standard APIs and logs. So I work in guidance software. I'm a forensic guy by nature, and I want to kind of differentiate what is different about my world than most other security vendors. And really what it is if you talk to your endpoint's operating system through an API and you ask them what's running on your endpoint, or you look in a log and look at log file entries and say, you know, what's going on, what type of evidence do we see in the log? At that kind of surface level of examination, you're really trusting the operating system and applications to tell you what they know is going on. Well, really what they know is going on and what they're willing to tell you. And that's a very surface level. Because in forensics, what happens is there's all kind of things that, you know, if you're a developer, a Linux developer, or a developer of Windows, you're doing all kinds of things inside of the code, you know, when you're writing the code for the operating system. And you're keeping track of stuff. You're storing things in super obscure system files that you have no intention of users ever looking inside. You're leaving things in like the deep crevices of the file system and memory, which would be this next very deep level of forensic evidence. And what's really cool about the forensic community is there's this big open source community called the DFIR community, hashtag DFIR. And they're constantly going out and they're finding all this forensic residue, all these artifacts, as we call them, reverse engineering and figuring out what they mean. They're even doing things like going onto the memory, pulling bytes off of the memory chip to see what's about to be executed by the CPU. And some of the things that are about to be executed by the CPU, the operating system doesn't even know about. I mean, if you have a rootkit, the rootkit's below the awareness of the operating system. So guys doing memory forensics, I'm just curious, do we have any memory forensics people here? Do any at all volatility? No? Yeah, some? It's very obscure. I mean, essentially what they're doing, I mean, they're almost looking into the operating system's subconscious, because the operating system isn't aware this thing's about to execute. So some pretty advanced stuff. So we'll drop some of these dots in the center as we go through with what the bad guys are doing and where they leave evidence in memory. All right. So the piece of malware that I'm going to show you is a Trojan. It's I decided to do this with Remote Access Trojan. Not ransomware is like the cool thing everybody's talking about. But the Remote Access Trojans, or nobody agrees with what means. Is it Remote Access Trojan? Is it Remote Administrator Tool? Remote Access Tool? I actually looked up the person who first discovered it in Wikipedia, and they don't agree. But anyway, it's Trojan. And I picked that because that's more likely to be used by state actors, especially against government targets, where ransomware tends to be more cybercrime, you know, organized crime, etc. Also, if you look on last year's Verizon DBIR report, Trojans were the biggest part of the Sinister Seven of the most common pieces of malware. And I also picked it for a couple other reasons. I highly recommend if you have the opportunity to play with malware, that you do it, because you really get into the bad guy's head, and you'll kind of see the way they operate, and hopefully that helps you be a step ahead of them. So this slide here, we're going to see reoccurring. This is the bad guy's lair. He's a Windows user, amazingly enough. And this is one of these Trojans, Ghost Rat. And this is actually probably a little bit of a simpler one, but most of them have UIs that are about this simple. Remember back in the day, Google kind of, for some of the old school people, I'm kind of old school, but remember Google kind of revolutionized user experience by having this clean search engine with just a text box. And they said the way they did it is they told their developers, make it so simple that you think your mom can use it. Well, as you walk through this, I think most of you will agree and be surprised that your mom can own people's endpoints with this malware. It's that easy. So we're in weaponization. Okay, so what do we got to do? We got to build some polymorphic malware, some zero days. This is the UI here. It's got three tabs. First tab is build. It's got some text on there, but there's only one button. Let's click the button. Now, when you click this button, it spits out a Trojan binary file. And if you click the button, one binary file gets spit out in a second, just like that. You click the file again, a second binary gets spit out. Each of these binaries has a unique file hash, right? Now think about that for a second. Since it's a unique file hash, when you search in, you know, the cloud threat intelligence databases, you're not going to find this hash because it's brand new and unique. Now, if you were a bad guy and you're sitting in your, you know, your hacker lair, I wish I had a better word for that, so it's easy to say hacker lair, but I'm saying and you're building these, and it takes 1 second to make a zero-day hash binary file, and you're sitting there knowing you're going to hack OPM and Ashley Madison, why would you use the same file with the same hash at both Ashley Madison and OPM? If it takes a second to make a new one, you probably wouldn't. Interestingly enough, on the Verizon DBIR report, this malware has been used for the last couple of years, and I was actually surprised how much people were still using hash-based signatures. If you look at the Verizon DBIR report last year, though, they report that 70 to 90% of malware that was found in an organization had a hash unique to that organization. So if they were to search threat intelligence, they're the only organization with that hash that aren't going to find it. Which makes our jobs a little more difficult, because now instead of just, you know, asking about hashes, you have to upload files for sandboxing, binary analysis, etc. All right. So let's move on now. Now you have some zero-day polymorphic malware, and you need to deliver it to your target. So what's the most common attack vector these days? Phishing, spear phishing. Absolutely. I assume it's my take on it is it's the easiest because you can patch your software, but it's harder to patch your employees. They'll click on links. You know, they could probably fool me with a good one. You know, a good offer maybe. So you're the bad guy, you do a little social engineering, spend some time on LinkedIn, make a flashy little email, and some of them are pretty clever, and you email it to somebody. And how long does that take to do a little research on LinkedIn, make an email, and send it, and wait for someone to click? A couple days, maybe? It's pretty simple. But when that email hits your network, you're obviously going to leave a fair bit of evidence behind. You're going to be able to go and do an email investigation. You're going to find the phishing emails. You're going to see if the user clicked the link, it's going to be in the web browsing history. If they decide not to use a spear phishing type attack, they can do the old trick where they drop the flashy USB drive in the parking lot. And, you know, you get that thing, you got to stick it in and see what it is, I guess, but it happens. And then all the user has to do is click the link, and their code is executing locally on the box. Some malicious code is starting to operate on the endpoint, and that's the exploitation stage. Done through some type of vulnerability, or the user is just plain old downloading the malware and running it. Now, again, you're going to see some of the same forensic evidence. By the way, I only have 45 minutes. I don't have time to go into the forensic evidence in super great detail. It's also, some of it's a little obscure. Don't worry about that. Has anyone heard of the SANS Institute? Any SANS people here? Cool. They make this awesome poster that I have on my wall, everybody should have on their wall. And it literally lists pretty much most all of the known forensic evidence in a little chart where it's like, what do you look for a user clicking something? You know, where's the evidence if a process runs? And they list pretty much out all the forensic artifacts. You don't have to memorize this stuff. I'm gonna give a mile high talk about this and talk relatively quickly about it. Don't worry about memorizing it all, just get the chart and you'll be able to do this stuff yourself. So exploitation, I already talked about USB drives. If it's a USB attack, every USB drive is put into a machine. There's a history of them all, what user did it at the time. It even has the unique manufacturer serial number, so we know which particular USB drive it is. Obviously, web, you know, a lot of history there. Email attachment, when you click an email attachment in something like Outlook, one interesting thing that happens is the file's cached locally. So if you just look in this cache folder, any files you see there, that's evidence that a user clicked it. So these are some things you could do to see the evidence of this spear phishing or phishing attack starting off a breach. And of course, you're gonna see files created on the disk and you're gonna see process history. I know a lot of people these days are, you know, they want to see the malware run in a sandbox if it cooperates with the sandbox, so they're putting these continuous monitoring agents on the endpoint. But you can see Windows reports all the processes that run, all the DLLs they load, files it opens. And the reason it does this is years ago they launched a feature called Prefetch, which you've probably heard of. And Prefetch is their attempt to make your user experience faster. They keep track of what you like to run, what files you like to open, so they can cache them in advance. And you can go in these prefetch files and see the past history of things that have ran. Most forensic evidence comes down to that. The operating system likes to track you guys because it wants to make the experience better for you and needs to keep track of stuff. All right. Installing malware is actually surprisingly similar to installing software. You run a process that installs. It drops a bunch of files on your drive, creates new files. It puts temp files that have to be deleted at some point during the installation. If you install an application, they talk to a licensing server on the internet. Well, malware typically talks to a command and control server on the internet that the hacker keeps. And so you're gonna see the kind of forensic evidence you would expect during an installation process. All right, so at this point in time, the bad guy has sent an email he probably spent a couple days on doing the research. A user clicked a link. Malicious code entered into the endpoint, started executing. Probably took less than a second. Installation occurred. I know, how long does it take to install malware? A minute. Really, the bad guy spent 2 days and some change to bypass your perimeter. It's quite simple. In these first few stages of the cyber kill chain model, go really quick, just like that. Now, this is what it actually looks like for him. He sent out the phishing email, and he's just waiting for one of those four users, available users, to click the link. And so he brings up the ghost rat, and he goes to the connection tab. And he has a malicious command and control server out on the internet. And all he's doing is once the Trojans installed the endpoint, it's going to beacon back to the command and control server, and all of a sudden it'll appear in his connection tab. He's going to see a line. He's going to see that he now owns one of these machines at Acme Corporation. Pretty simple. And like I said before, even your mom can own people with this. Just right click drop down. You want a remote shell, you want a file manager to upload and download new files, drop some more 0 days. It's really that simple, super simple. So now he's in the box, you're in command and control. Now, one endpoint is owned, so the next most common activity you're gonna see is lateral movement. The bad actor is going to want to get onto more and more of your endpoints to get closer to your valuable assets. You might want to get access to your domain controller so he can really have escalated, you know, the type of escalated privileges so he can really see everything he needs to. But command and control takes many, many months, and lateral movement is one of the big activities that occur during command and control. So that's why I have this pie slice really big. This is 90% of the time. Most breaches take over a year, so this is where it really happens. And it's not just moving laterally to get privileges, it's also searching for data as well. And you're gonna see lots of different pieces of forensic evidence. We're gonna stick on this pie slice for a little while. One thing you should think about with malware is malware needs to survive reboots. So if you go on your computer and you start Microsoft Word, it runs, it needs the users to start it, and if your system reboots, when it comes back up, Microsoft Word's not gonna be rerunning again unless you click it. So they have to create some type of persistence mechanism so when a system reboots, the malware doesn't, the malware's not killed. And the typical ways they do that are activity in the registry that will set up auto run keys. So when your system reboots, it'll start up the malware automatically. So you can actually, if you know where the registry to look, you can find these keys and they'll actually tell you where the malware is, what the binary is that's automatically starting upon boot. Not everything that's auto run is malware, but that's a very easy place to find some advanced persistent threats. Task scheduler is another one. We'll use the Windows task scheduler, make sure it's run every so often, so if it's killed, it'll restart. You may see rootkits that you have to look for in memory, doing memory forensics probably, or some advanced detection. And rootkits are used so that they can hide their tracks, so that they can hide files, and even hide registry keys so you can't see them. And of course, you're going to see a lot of lateral movements. So looking for evidence of endpoints talking to each other, endpoints that you wouldn't normally expect to talk directly to each other. All right. So here's an interesting part of command and control I don't think people think a whole lot about. So once you've moved laterally to a few different endpoints, what you're going to try to do is you're going to try to get credentials. You're going to try to escalate privileges. You're going to try to find, local admin, domain admin, so that you can really access valuable assets and get sensitive data on the network. Now, once you have one of these privileged accounts, why would you keep going around infecting new endpoints with malware when you can just blend in with all the users, hide in plain sight, pretend like you're a user because you're remotely controlling this account, and just start logging into machines? And that's what happens in a lot of breaches. There'll be a rogue user account that it looks like a user, could be an insider threat, or it could be externally controlled. So this is something to really think about at this point in a breach in command and control. And one of the cool things, one of the other things I want to mention too, before I talk about investigating users, is the forensic techniques to investigate users are really good for this part of command and control. But also the bad guys like to do, if you invested this time, you've invested months moving around looking for stuff, you're going to want to cover your tracks, you're going to want to do anti-forensics. The interesting thing about forensics, that one of the takeaways you should really get from any time that you look at what kind of forensic evidence is left behind, is any activity a user or an application does with an operating system, anytime it interacts with it, it leaves some residue behind. So if you want to go back and delete forensic evidence, the act of deleting forensic evidence leaves evidence of anti-forensics. So forensics is actually an interesting area because it's very difficult for the bad guys to clean up their trail of breadcrumbs that leads to what they're doing. All right, so let's go back to what I was talking about a second ago. So users, once a user account has been, or you have credentials and you want to hide in plain sight and behave like a user and log into servers, log into your CEO's laptop and start searching for data. One thing to really think about is, at this point in time, the bad actor or the adversary, he's like a guy that is browsing lots of your data, searching for lots of your data. And Windows And Linux, to less of a degree, love to track everything users do. Just like I was mentioning earlier, they like to do it for usability purposes. When you're in Microsoft Word or you're trying to start an application and it automatically shows you, you know, recently run things you used or recently opened documents, that's because it's tracking everything you're doing. And it's doing that so it helps you get the things you need quicker. Do we have any guys that, I'm gonna ask another old school tech question. You remember way back in the day when Microsoft took on Netscape and they unseated them as the browser we all used early in the internet. And they had this interesting argument they made. They said, well, we have to package IE inside of Windows for free because all of the graphical user interfaces in Windows, the back end is a web browser, which seemed a little hokey at the time. But the interesting thing about that is it's very true, when you go into my computer, my desktop file manager, and you bring that thing up, the back end of that is the same as IE. So every time you're clicking a file, every time you're browsing a folder, it's storing a history of that in an obscure place of your IE internet browsing history. So literally, it's gonna show, you know, Dave clicked at this time, this file, he went in this folder at this time, and it's gonna give this full chronological history of everything you clicked, who you were, etc. Some other examples of ways it detracts you. If you click a file on a device, on a USB drive, on a drive on your system, it leaves these little obscure system files that you can't see called LNK files. It tells you the user they clicked at the time, the file that was clicked, all that normal stuff. But one very interesting thing about it is inside the LNK file, it stores the unique manufacturer serial number of the device you clicked the file on. So if one of you gave me your USB drives and we stuck it in my endpoint, and my laptop, and I clicked the file, I would have a history that I had your drive with your unique manufacturer serial number here. And then if we investigated your laptop at your office, we could see that we both shared the same USB drive, and we could even see which file we clicked. So there's just loads and loads and loads of forensic residue. I'm sorry, Jake.
For the IE tracking, would that take place even if you had caching turned off?
Yes, it would. So it's very easy to become paranoid when you learn about forensics, and that certainly happened to me in the beginning, but everything you're doing is being tracked, let's put it this way. So, and that's the great strength of forensics, which came particular when it comes to looking at what rogue user accounts are doing under the control of external adversaries. Because forensics came out of this world of investigating users, investigating criminals, etc. And so, forensic tools are excellent at seeing this part of a breach.
Students.
Yeah.
So if the attacker knows to use PowerShell,
Okay, that's an excellent question. So, if you use a command line shell like PowerShell or DOS prompt, will you leave as much forensic evidence behind? You will not leave as much forensic evidence behind. The graphical shell is where they do all their usability stuff and track you. So, more tracking is being done there. However, the PowerShell and the DOS prompt, you will actually have histories of those in memory, so you can use volatility, for instance, to see the history of all the command line things that were run. So some forensic evidence is in memory and it lasts hours. Some is on the disk and lasts many, many years. That's a good way to think of it. Now, ultimately, like I was just saying, your adversary, he's searching for data. He's trying to find your customer records. He's trying to find credit card numbers. He's trying to find trade secrets, intellectual property, financial information. And you're in an interesting place. Oh, I don't want to go that slide yet. You're in a very interesting place in InfoSec where we're in a post-perimeter world. You can buy all the fancy perimeter technology you want, but you know when the phishing email comes in, it gets bypassed by a silly user that clicks a link, or a USB drive gets plugged in, or BYOD, BYOD, why are we doing BYOD in the middle of a cyber war? Anybody ever ask themselves that question? We take our personal device and do who knows what on the internet, and we just walk right through the perimeter and infect our organizations. I mean, I actually know why we're doing it, because my company doesn't have to pay for a phone anymore, so it's a cost-saving measure. That's what it is. And I think that's going on across the industry. It was really a cost-saving measure. But it makes your job more difficult. So what I'm getting at here is we live in a post-perimeter world, and your job as an InfoSec person is the battle's going on inside your perimeter. You're trying to keep threats, malware, rogue user accounts away from this sensitive data. This leads me to an important question. Do you guys know where the sensitive data is on your network? Because I ask this all the time, and almost everyone's like, no. And I mean, it's kind of crazy. You're in the middle of a cyber war, and you're given this impossible task to protect parts of your network. You don't know which parts to protect. And I think a big part of it, and it's definitely not your fault, I think a big part of it is the disconnect between the kinds of people who know what the sensitive data look like and the kinds of people that defended InfoSec. For instance, if you work for Coca-Cola, InfoSec probably cannot find intellectual property because they're not going to be told the secret ingredients to Coca-Cola. If you work at KFC, you've never seen the 11 herbs and spices. That document might be right there, but you don't know which they are, if that's actual intellectual property, right? That's a huge disconnect between InfoSec and information governance, compliance, the chief privacy officer, whoever it is, the guy that knows what the data looks like and where it is. And so I think this is a big, one of my darkening articles was actually about this. This would be a big boon for the industry if these two groups got together and actually work together so they could give you a map of, here's where my important endpoints are. Maybe only 5% of your endpoints actually have privileged data on it. And you can prioritize your defense around 5% of your endpoints. You can adjust your incident response playbook and processes around that. Maybe you spend a little more money on the budget for that 5% of your security products even. So I think this is a huge, you know, it's about bureaucracy, you know, communication with organizations, but I think this is actually a big area of the industry to do a better job at. All right, so the bad guys have got your sensitive data, and they, you know, they tend to zip it up, package it, encrypt it, and like I'm saying, even your mom can do this. She right-clicks on the endpoint that she found sensitive data, and she says, file manager, and I kid you not, the file manager for this malware is actually easier to use than any FTP client I've ever seen. Get the sensitive data on the endpoint you just hacked, drag it up so it gets uploaded to your command and control server, and you've just stolen the crown jewels. All right. Let's see what time we got here. Okay. So Before we talk a little more about the forensic evidence there, I just want to point out that the other big issue with finding your sensitive data is it's stored in all kind of weird formats. It's in email, it's on SharePoint, it's in proprietary document repositories, email repositories, archiving systems, it's in the cloud. So actually, you're just technically searching for it is actually a big deal. And so you need the technology to search for it, you need the people with the privileged roles and can look at, you know, insider trading financial documents, or, you know, see what the proprietary ingredients to Coca-Cola are. They need to work with that software, figure out where it is and share it with you. So that's actually a bit of work to do. But anyway, once it's found and they're uploading it, more forensic evidence is left behind. You know, network uploads, you'll find encrypted files in the disk, you'll find zip files where everything's packaged up. They tend not to want to do a lot of it at one time because it tends to trip off intrusion protection systems, etc. If you find one of these files that's encrypted on your disk that you think might store data they stole, decrypting their file, cracking their file can be a little tough. Just one thing I'll mention is I'm still amazed when I look in memory how many passwords are in plain text. Whatever the software they're using, when they enter the password, it goes into a variable. If you ever done any programming with that variable, it sits in memory. It's right there in memory somewhere. A lot of times, the easiest way to find it is if you know what goes with passwords, a username, we look for the username in memory within a few bytes before or after you'll see that password plain text. It's a long shot, but I just thought I'd throw that in there. All right. So I just want one other thing I wanted to mention. So I showed you a relatively simple Trojan here that has a super simple UI, and most of them actually do have UIs as simple as this. Creating the zero-day polymorphic hash was ridiculously simple. You hit the button, it comes out. Hash-based signatures. One of our takeaways from this is hash-based signatures a little sketchy going forward, especially when we see last year they were unique to organizations. There are more advanced signatures we've been using over the past few years, like indicators of compromise, which are a little more complicated than just the hash. Sometimes they have behavioral information like, you know, what IP address it connected to, registry keys attached, etc. But if you look at some of these Trojans, on that build tab, they'll actually have a checkbox, and you can pick, you know, do this behavior, inject this way. So it'll even change the IOC for each of these binary variants. So it's really getting harder and harder to detect malware. That's why you see vendors doing, you know, using artificial intelligence or machine learning, which is good in some malware, but it's not, believe me, I've worked in this space with Caltech and I've been evaluating a lot of external technologies. It's not a silver bullet that's gonna solve everything, but it should be another thing we use going forward. But one of the important things I want you to take away from here is everything leaves behind forensic evidence. No matter what zero-day malware or what kind of advanced threat, there's going to be forensic evidence on your disk, if even only evidence that they cleaned themselves up and left evidence of anti-forensics. So if you're examining a system and you see that someone's cleaning up obscure entries in system files, that's enough to suspect you have a security incident on your endpoint. All right, I have some screen caps here from a new product we have so that you can actually track your sensitive data and you can in InfoSec work with people from information governance, but I'm really good at the product, so I'm not gonna talk about that so much. Let's get to the big payoff here. So this is where all the evidence plotted out. So some takeaways, I kind of already started these talking about malware is simpler to use than you thought. It's easier to build zero days and polymorphic. As I've kind of been harping on through this breach, the initial stages of the cyber kill chain, delivery, exploitation, installation, happen really quick. The big work, you know, that these guys, your adversary, has to go through is in command and control. It lasts months and months and months, and the evidence leaves behind massive amounts of forensic evidence that spread across many, many endpoints. So when you think about a breach, think about command and control, think about a person, think about lateral movement, think about the kind of things you would have to do to browse around and search for data, think about the evidence that's left behind. And then of course, the other thing is try to find out where your sensitive data is. It could make your lives easier. That's another takeaway I would say. All right. I think I only have a couple minutes left, so I do want to do some questions. Before I do questions, I want to make a comment about forensics and do a quick plug. I know forensics requires some expertise, and a lot of times companies don't have it, or they don't have the people, or they don't have time for people to do it. Well, new technologies are coming out that automates forensic investigations, that automates just analytics that looks for any strange anomaly, that automates combining those with detection technologies. We have one of these, it's in the cloud, it automates all the work, it threat scores it, and amazingly enough with this new technology, a single one of our consultants can walk into your environment and do a full investigation on 2,000 of your endpoints in a single week, and that's because all the forensics was automated, it's all threat scored, and they're actually putting eyes on all the important threats. It's the deepest investigation you'll ever get. It doesn't even need deploying agents, it's agentless. And we're trying to showcase the new technology, so we have it priced that it's literally $3 a note. It's ridiculously cheap because we're highlighting the technology. Anybody's interested, I get some cards up here. But let's open for questions.
Yeah,
Yeah.
Did you have a question?
Yeah, very good. Anybody have any questions? Yes, sir.
I like your circle. What are the street related to him? So security is obviously being greater than the building and the brother of the street related to him.
Yep.
All the street.
And if anyone wants to email me, I can send you the slides as well. Although I think InfoSec has them as well. So basically, it's taking me way longer to get back here. All right. So here's really the layers here. The surface layer, just standard APIs and logs. You know, what does the operating system and applications know about? What are they willing to tell you? Then it's all kind of like obscure system files that have to be reverse engineered, but they're undocumented. OS vendor didn't want you to know what's inside of them. So there's this community. Go to hashtag DFIR, you can see these guys. Go to trade shows like HCCIA. My company goes to NFU's one, it's a really big show. And then the deep memory and file system analysis. This is like really digging into like the core stuff that the operating system is leaving behind. Got another? Yeah.
All over the place.
Yep.
And it sounds like you're usually all accurate.
Yep.
How do we move that ball to the school? So is there any movement? You have all this data all over the place, essentially mining. Say,
yes.
It's too much for even a small organization to get here to invest that.
So the question is, you know, forensics is after the fact, which is very true. And he's asking how we can move to detecting this stuff before the fact. So, there's all kind of software that does do intrusion protection, detect, you know, endpoint protection. The thing is forensic moves around a lot of I/O and a lot of data. So constantly seeing that deep of visibility and tripping things up immediately is a little more difficult. There are new technologies coming out where they utilize the instead of moving all the forensic data centrally, then cranking on it, where they utilize the endpoint CPU to help out that are coming out, but I think you'll start to see more of that. But a lot of it has to do with I/O. I mean, think about memory. I mean, how big is memory? It's pretty big. It's many, many gigs that you have to go through. That's a lot different than just calling a few operating system APIs and saying, is this happening? If so, I'll throw an alert. So forensics is harder to do, and it's harder to, automatically do really quickly, I would say. But yeah, the industry wants to go that way, what you're asking for. Any other questions? Yes, sir.
How often do you spend looking outside the or after the institution, organization, digital? Obviously, you have to change your ad, profile, what about looking at the routers outside the router of the street is maybe clear if everything there with the traffic sentiments all in there and it's all traffic as well.
Yeah, so he's talking about really internet forensics moving out of the perimeter and looking for what's out there. Threat intelligence is a way that while it's hard to look up hashes, there's only so many command and control servers, so looking up is this an IP known with a known bad actor, but you're actually asking about like evidence on the public internet. I don't know how to get access to that except for hacking for attribution, which is technically illegal. I don't want to donate my time to the public system.
It's more directed at you're a large organization.
Yeah.
You get attacked. Somebody gets a server. What is it when you do a call out? Like a malware does a call out and it's hidden and it's like telling Microsoft, I'm taking Microsoft, it's a large file that's coming out.
Yep.
Well, you can follow it to your head, right? But if you suspect it's something more, then of course you can reach out to the ISP of that node.
Yep.
And you can say, okay, from this point, try to track and trace it back.
Yeah.
But essentially a lot of things are disappearing inside of your network, will reappear there.
No, that's a good point. That would be a great way to kind of hone in on where they are And if you're you know, that proactive, which sounds like you are, and you have the time and expertise to do that, that's great. You know, I'm not sure all organizations have, you know, people like yourself that can do that, but that's a good point. Yes, sir.
Trying on the command control service outside the network, is there any information that you can offer regarding how long I have to sit for a command control service? So,
yeah.
So that guy has a couple months in here. I guess it's got to be a specialized attack, right? As opposed to pressing itself in the network and getting top faster.
That's a great question. I thought about this. I don't have, and his, what his question is the command and control server on the internet, how long is it up for? You know, we know it, you know, there's IP addresses being connected to from your network to this particular command and control server. How many of them does the hacker have? How often does he refresh them? You know, how many layers of indirection are there? How long do they stay there? I don't know. That's a great question. I thought about that a lot myself. When I look at through the bad guy's eyes and I see the way that they sidestep all the new stuff the security industry is building, and I see how easy it is to do a zero-day hash, how easy it is to make a polymorphic piece of malware that alters your IOC, I think about what are things they can change easily, and I think you hit on it. The command and control servers that are out there are one that's it's more difficult for them to change. You know, the FBI and Interpol and, you know, all these guys are constantly looking for them, and actually they are able to legally hack them, and so they're under attack there, but they do have to keep them up for a period of time because all, you know, they're in the middle of breaches with a number of organizations, and that malware out there, it's just a relatively dumb piece of software. It only knows about so many command and control servers to connect to, so they have to leave them up there. Now, one thing I didn't show you is when you set up the malware, you can set up a number of command and control servers. So we'll try the first one. If that one's been taken down, I'll try the second. You'll try the third. But that's a great bottleneck that the bad guys have to go through. I would say bottlenecks where you have somewhat of an advantage, look for the command and control server, and there's always forensic evidence behind. Any other questions? Yes, ma'am.
About 30% of whole companies don't even have an incident response plan.
Yeah.
The ones that do get their act together, why would they invest in forensics
instead of
just an IR plan?
Well, I mean, forensics and, well, I think of forensics and IR the same. I mean, traditionally, IR came out of the forensics industry way back in the day. I think your IR tool should do forensics, but I think it comes down to you have different tiers of incident response. Typically, you know, the tier one guy may not have all the expertise to dig in with forensics. They might just be looking to validate, triage incidents very rapidly, and then but they're going to be stuff where you want to escalate it to someone who can do a little more forensics. And the question is, do you want to find the whole breach, or do you just want to clean up one endpoint when there's five of them that are infected? So every organization has to make that decision for themselves when they think about the ROI of keeping the talent, et cetera. And that's why for us, it is tough to get forensic people. That's why, you know, we're focusing on, like, I plug this new tech. It's a service, but it's a new technology we might even leave behind for some of you guys to play with that we might offer in the future that automates all the forensics. Is that a good answer? Okay. Yes, in the back, sir.
Tied to that, you have two things that you're talking about. The incident response is great. Stop the bad thing that's happening. But then you want to know where did it happen? How did it happen? Why did it happen? Is it still going to happen again when you turn something back on? And the forensics answer is a good piece of that.
Yep. Yeah, how deep do you take it? Do you go all the way back to finding out which user clicked the phishing email? Was it him or was it the insider threat that's going to keep occurring? Do you need to remind your employees again not to stick in the USB drive? I mean, you can take these forensic investigations pretty far. And certainly taking a forensic tool and taking a forensic image of memory and the disk is a good thing to do during incident response, because when you get that call from the FBI, do you want to worry about the interaction there? You just want to turn over the images. I think most people would just like turn them over and not have to stay up at night thinking about that.
But if you ask for your credit card, hang up.
Any other questions? Yep.
Without plugging in particular software, what would you prefer the top new software you should use to investigate cyber
incidents? Okay. I'm trying to think how I can give a plug in software, but. Obviously,
I'm going to try to use
your
time. Yeah. What is your advice?
So obviously I'm saying in case, you know, I don't actually look, so he's asking about Slack space, which is basically, that's the most IO intensive and time consuming type of forensics you can do, because it doesn't just look inside all the files in the disk, it looks inside every single cluster and looks for like these extra spaces where files are. And it takes a long, I don't do a lot of it, I use our product, and I know there's some open source ones to do. Honestly, I don't have a good answer to that. Anybody else?